Funding for Expedition Florida is provided by Babcock Ranch Swamp Buggy and Off-Road Echo Bike Tours. Babcock Ranch is dedicated to conserving the Telegraph Swamp and Florida's wildlife for future generations. Additional support was provided by Forever Florida and Florida Echo Safaris, offering visitors guided nature tours on comfortable coaches or horseback. Forever Florida's mission is to preserve our unique wilderness habitats and natural beauty.
The Florida Museum of Natural History holds more than 25 million specimens and artifacts in its collection. Making these Florida treasures accessible to the public presents new challenges as we enter the 21st century. In From Exploration to Exhibition, scientists, curators, and artists are reshaping traditional concepts of artifact display. This is their story.
In 1968, when I first came up here on the river, it was a clear spring, and in about an hour of scuba diving, I saw 11 skeletons of mammoths and mastodons. These sinkholes in the bottom of this river are like a time machine. The sediments slowly stack up, and each layer is a little chapter. And what's neat from our point of view as explorers is that those wet sinkholes slowly backfilled as the ice ages ended. And the record of those sediments included earliest peoples, extinct animals, and this backfilling episode. And that's what we go in the river to excavate.
Florida Museum of Natural History was chartered by the legislature in 1917, so that makes us over 80 years old at the present time. Since that time, it has grown to become the largest collection-based museum in the southeastern United States and probably the most comprehensive university-based natural history museum in the country. So the citizens of Florida should be quite proud of this institution that has grown to such enormous capacity in 80 years.
Here in the Aucilla River and in the Aucilla, we've got about a dozen major sites, and we're continuing to work and daily find exciting new features about the earliest people. Then there was a 15-year lapse before we got back up here. The impetus was a bison skull with a spear point right in the frontal bone and part of a bison kill site. So it's a paleontologist's and archaeologist's dream up here once you learn how to get through the water to the bottom.
This site, Sloth Hole, is a focus of my master's and dissertation research. We have both a mastodon butchery from around 11,000 years ago and a campsite from around 10,000 years ago.
All right, the last bit of mapping of the contours of the unit we'll have to do, we'll start around unit 57 where the tusk came out, and as we work to the north, we'll cover the units where the worked ivory came from.
This 7.5-foot tusk that was recovered in intact sediments in another section of the Aucilla River here that ended up being 7.5-foot long. And it was preserved exquisitely in sediments that had stained it golden orange colored. And it was just a magnificent experience to be there as the excavators slowly uncovered the sediments millimeter by millimeter until this glorious tusk glowed orange in the otherwise dark water on the bottom.
The thrill of the discovery is every day always with us because we are constantly running into either butchered bones of an articulated mastodon or some of the other pieces, such as an ivory foreshaft fragment that we found just a few days ago. Only one implement like this has been found west of the Mississippi, and here at Sloth Hole we've covered 60 fragments that seem to represent about 35 tools like this one. This example is 33.3 centimeters long, and when complete would have been about 40 centimeters long, making it far and away the largest ivory object that's been found in North America.
Some of the things that come out of the river are very special. The lithic points, like the Clovis points, the classic Western ones, but then a lot of Florida varieties, Swanee points, Bolin points, stuff through time that culturally evolved. Also, we get very special preservation of bones, ivory, and wood that's sealed off in the river sediments. When we first find them, sometimes they turn brown on exposure to oxygen or sunlight, but they're beautiful.
All right, I got enough pigment now. I think it should match pretty good.
Okay, looks good.
Being able to cast these things and distribute them to other scientists and share the information without having the object travel, it's a very delicate object.
Okay, looks like a good color match on the ivory.
All right, we just gotta fill the barb right now. Okay, and if you can tap that and get the bubbles out of the end of it. Should run out a little bit, but not too bad.
Well, here we have a cast of a barbed ivory piece from very nearby. The barbed ivory piece is very important because, as far as we know, it's unique, and it's clearly a point. It's not part of the foreshaft or point debate that rages among archaeologists.
There you go. Tap it a little bit. That should be full, so it should be okay now.
These are finished casts of the very large Clovis point and the barbed ivory point, which now can be put on display in the exhibit hall or can be sent to other scientists worldwide for comparative purposes.
The satisfaction that I've received in my 30 years in this river, and indeed the whole project has received in the last 15 of very intense work, is impossible to describe. The museum and people of the future will benefit from this, but I think those of us that were directly involved are very, very privileged.
I've been coming to this part of Florida for about 40 years. I find it very unique and an exciting place to visit, and I'd like to share these ideas and this environment with other folks. One of the advantages of creating an exhibit in a museum is that we can control things that wouldn't be controlled in the wild. In our exhibit, we've tried to compress time. Many of the flowers that we have in the exhibit, actually their blooming times are spread over a longer period of time, but we're showing them as blooming all at the same time. This cave is formed in Eocene limestone about 45 million years ago. It was formed at the bottom of shallow marine sea, probably very similar to what the Bahamas look like today. Well, all the formations in the cave form by water. The water is the mechanism by which the cave passage, the space forms.
Mark, where are we?
We just passed through the original entry room, Dick. That's where they first discovered this cave system back in 1937. Government surveyor found where a big oak tree had fallen down, and when the roots ripped out of the ground, it exposed the cave system.
When this cave fills with air, then these decorations form, and they're formed by the action of water. It deposits small amounts of calcium carbonate in particular fashions that create the stalactites occur at on the ceiling, the stalagmites occur on the floor. When the two grow together, they form a column. It's the dripping water that causes all these decorations to form. And the rimstone pools also form by water being agitated as it flows over rough surfaces. The crawfish that lives in this cave and caves in the Mariana area is a unique species. It's blind, it's white, and has many interesting life history patterns. It probably lives a long time. Some studies indicate that some of the cave crayfishes may live more than 200 years. Now, there are several salamanders which occur in this cave system. Some of them occur outside the cave. Now, the three-line salamander is very common in these caves, and they will lay eggs in water. The eggs will hatch into larvae, and in many cases you'll find the larvae in these pools also. The slimy salamander, which is also very common outside, does not lay its eggs in water. It lays its eggs on land. But frequently, these salamanders will invade the cave. The two major focuses of the North Florida exhibit is water and biodiversity. And this area is uniquely watered by the Chipola River. It has a unique set of plants and animals that occur here. These animals are more Appalachian in their relationships, and it's this unique combination of water and these plants that make the Florida Caverns so interesting. Probably one of the most unique features of Florida Caverns State Park is this limestone escarpment that runs along the Chipola River. Because there's a very little soil present on this limestone, it allows a number of plants that are uniquely Appalachian to occur here, which makes this part of Florida very unique. The Florida Caverns area exhibit includes this escarpment and a cave. We have set the escarpment exhibit in early spring, and during this period of time, the leaves in the canopy, the larger trees, are just beginning to form after winter. And this allows a lot of light to strike the limestone, and as a consequence, you get this bloom of spring wildflowers, which is a unique display in Florida.
The Florida Cavern State Park, in the six-week period, usually between about March 1st and April 15th, is a fairyland of beautiful wildflowers, and we wanted to capture this whole beautiful rainbow of spring. The first thing I did was go to Mariana and do some sketches and take some panoramic photographs where I ended up taping together a whole slew, like five or six photos, to get the feeling of the place and the sort of horizontal continuity. Then we worked on making studies. We made an inch to a foot model, and the foreground was sculpted in, and then I did a drawing that would fit into the background, and I could erase and try different scenarios until I had something that looked like it would work in the space at an inch to a foot. Then I came in here and there was this huge giant blank room, and I gridded it up from an inch to a foot, so it was 12 times as large as the model. and it was pretty easy to get the whole thing up there, and it looked, you know, like a great big sketch, and it all made sense. But then trying to fill in all the details, the color, the light, then it became a big challenge. Both the artwork and the endeavor that we had done, and also they became aware of a new ecosystem. And we really care here about people being aware of the wonderful specific ecosystems in Florida and preserving them.
I'm a curator in archaeology at the Florida Museum of Natural History, and I've been working in South Florida for the last 15 years or so. My role in this exhibit is to work on a team with other people to help bring some of that knowledge to the public.
When people think of archaeology, I think they usually think of Indiana Jones tearing out of the Temple of Doom with a single artifact in his hand. But as archaeologists, we're anthropologists first. We study people. And so the artifacts are a way in which we learn about the social behavior, particularly seeing as the Calusa didn't have any written language. This is the only way that we can reconstruct the past.
We're in the inner sanctum of the museum, and this is where we store most of our rare and fragile artifacts. Frank Hamilton Cushing was an interesting guy. He was working at the time in the 1890s, and he came down to Florida and excavated the Key Marco site. What we never would have known had Frank Cushing not excavated this site, that people were also making objects like this out of wood. And what his excavation showed was that people were making all kinds of things out of wood. Beautiful little bowls like this, which probably were utilitarian, and carved objects like the wooden mask that were probably ceremonial, and then just everyday objects like these net floats here, which were used to keep the fishing nets afloat.
The masks are remarkable partly because they're so artistic. The painting is amazing. The carving is exquisite. They're very lifelike. It's tempting to speculate about how they might have been used. Truly, we don't know exactly, although Spanish accounts tell us that there were masked processions where people walked through the villages wearing these masks, and people were going alongside them singing and chanting. You can imagine in your mind's eye something like these masks being used in a situation like that, although we can't tell exactly how they were used. It's tempting to imagine a rhythm and music and singing and dancing, and these masks playing a very important role in the ceremonial life of these people. Well, we've done archaeology in South Florida for about 15 years. It's led to a real appreciation of the ingenuity and accomplishments of the Indian people who lived here before us. And we found that their fishing heritage goes back about 6,000 years. That was a big surprise to us. The Calusa are primarily a fishing people, so a lot of the activities that are going on in the village have to do with fishing. There are nets drying, there are people making canoes that they would use to go out and fish in. There are people fishing in tidal creeks. Trading canoes are coming in from the interior and bringing mats and hides and feathers and foodstuffs that are being traded in. Just a lot of activities, and this is a glimpse of the everyday life of the Calusa people maybe 1,000 years ago.
One of the things that's unique about the Calusa is they were politically complex society, what we call a complex chiefdom, where one chief ruled over many others. But the Calusa were a non-agricultural people, and 90% of their protein diet came from the estuaries. One of the more astounding finds at the Quimarco site were these extremely perishable nets made out of cabbage palm fibers. By taking the golden fibers of the cabbage palm and twisting them to the right and then wrapping them to the left, the Calusa manufactured these nets. By replicating artifacts, we learn a lot about how the artifacts would have actually functioned in their society. And therefore, these nets would have been extremely important to the Calusa because, really, they probably captured most of their protein diet with these nets.
Elliot, this is for the South Florida exhibit. Do you want to show us how this works?
This is a demo program right now. You can see the crab moves out of its hole.
That is so cool.
And all the pneumatics are under the ground, will be under the ground surface. So the crabs can come out of their hole at random. We can do a lot with the programming. So if I turn this on, it runs a simple program that brings the crab out of its hole, moves the claw back and forth, and each crab, which I'm hoping to have about 14, would be independently controlled. So they would all have their own little movements.
So, Stacy, could you tell us what's going to happen back in the mural there?
Well, it turns out that this panoramic photo that was shot when we went down to the site works really well in this model. You can see how the mangrove trees would just blend and the horizon mm-hmm. line would just be right about the viewer's 5 foot, mm-hmm. you know, eye line.
Yeah.
And then the sky can be a buildup of cumulus clouds in the afternoon building up mm-hmm. into a storm. And I think that would work well with the designer's idea for ceiling and lighting effects.
Having a big black warehouse of space is very much like a canvas for an artist. He can visualize all kind of imagery on that white space until he makes that first mark. And that first mark tends to destroy any illusion he has. The challenge from that point is then to create the image that he's carrying in his mind, which is partially reinforced and established by walking and actually observing the habitat that he's trying to create.
Yeah, the mural here is in an introductory area of the exhibit. It's a collage of images from South Florida. We have a Calusa Indian blowing a horn in the middle. We have a Seminole family, a Spanish-American fishing person. We have modern kids today kind of checking it out and thinking about maybe their role in the future as stewards of the environment and appreciating the heritage of South Florida. So it's kind of a mixture of images. It also shows the environment. The very important estuary environment that was so supportive of the Calusa people. As we learned about these people in the past, we've come to appreciate that the environment worked for them. And we think it's still doing the same thing for us today, we just haven't appreciated it quite as much. So we think that by telling this Indian story and people coming to appreciate that, that they'll be more conscious of what the environment does for them today, and they'll be more interested in helping to preserve it.
And in terms of the long-term scope, by learning how these people took care and managed this landscape for many thousands of years, this gives us a perspective from which to make decisions about the future. In other words, if you don't know your past, how can you possibly make decisions to guide your future?
Working with children and seeing them learn from our exhibits and other people is a tremendous joy. It's the joy that a teacher might have, seeing a spark go off in someone's mind as they understand something. And we hope that we can bring to the public the things that they can't normally experience.
The most exciting part of my job is to watch children come into the museum, to see them walk through the front door, have their eyes grow large as saucers, their jaws to drop open and say, "Wow, that's really cool, look at that mammoth." That to me makes everything that we do worthwhile.
Funding for Expedition Florida is provided by Babcock Ranch Swamp Buggy and Off-Road Echo Bike Tours. Babcock Ranch is dedicated to conserving the Telegraph Swamp and Florida's wildlife for future generations. Additional support was provided by Forever Florida and Florida Echo Safaris, offering visitors guided nature tours on comfortable coaches or horseback. Forever Florida's mission is to preserve our unique wilderness habitats and natural beauty.